How do we decide password strength when we generate new passwords? What cryptid would we be? I had to ask Nate what this was before we started recording. What do you think about the simulation hypothesis? Some Qubes questions, and then running your own Monero node and why that could be beneficial for some people. This is our Q&A, where we answer questions from people who directly support this podcast and keep it going. And this is our way of kind of giving back and engaging with all of you in kind of a fun way. If you want to join the next Q&A, you can do it on Patreon at patreon.com/surveillancepod. Or one of the questions this week came from XMR chat, where you don't need an account, you just send some Monero and you include a message, and then we can feature your question. And so you can check both of those out down in the description. We're going to start with David Johnson's question, which is, how do you guys as more advanced users approach deciding the optimal password strength across various use cases? One of his points also touches on other security considerations like 2FA and passphrases. 99% of the times, at least on my end, I generate a password inside of my password manager, and every time after that, I never have to manually type a password. So I think I have my password manager set to like 30, 35 characters or something, and occasionally I'll just modify it down if a certain site has some ridiculous requirement, like a max 20 character limit. I hate those websites. The only reason I kind of keep it at 35 and I don't make it 120 is A, the entropy is still really good, and it seems like you get a lot of diminishing returns. And I do fear the day where, you know, maybe I can't access the password or I can't type it in or something like that, so I have to actually write it out myself. And I think that is kind of a disaster waiting to happen. So I try to keep it somewhat manageable in the situation where that arises. And that includes passphrases as well, so kind of the same system there. I have a different system for things that I do anticipate having to type in. So things like Wi-Fi passwords and like master passwords for other things that I work on. Those passwords, I typically try to stick with passphrases because they're much easier to type. And I also try to keep it, you know, reasonable. You know, I might not do a whole 30 characters. I might keep it at like 20, 25, which I know some people might say isn't secure enough. But again, I think when I look at the entropy, I'm still pretty happy with it. Unless it's something that's like extremely sensitive, then of course I'll treat it a little bit better. But again, most of these things have 2FA as well. So just having a strong enough and unique password in addition with 2FA is going to put you in a really good place. So that's kind of my philosophy for how I do my passwords.
Yeah, I'm very similar. David wrote out a whole bunch of different scenarios and use cases, but I mean, my answer is kind of the same for all of them. So I tend to do 40 characters. And the reason I do that is the recommendation for a passphrase is like 4 to 6 words. And on average, that's about the same entropy as 40 characters. So that's kind of how I came up with that number. My minimum recommendation these days for any password is at least 16 characters. Anything more than 25, I think, is just kind of being an overachiever, to be honest. I think 25 is the minimum I would feel comfortable with, but it's not the end of the world. A quick note on that that Henry mentioned, I've heard people say that any website that puts a limit on passwords, that should be a red flag right there, because, and this kind of goes over my head, I don't remember where I read it, but it was somebody I trusted. Basically, what that means is the way they're hashing passwords is not great. Basically, you're using anything modern that's like currently well accepted. The hash is going to be the same length regardless. If they're putting a cap on it, that's a red flag.
A good way to put it is just there is no technical or non-technical reason to restrict password length.
Kind of with Henry, the only time I really use passphrases, because my thing with passphrases, a lot of people recommend them regardless, but there's so many websites that are like, no, you can't have spaces. You have to have uppercase and lowercase and special characters. And so I'm like, dude, if I just set it to 40 characters, all the requirements, and if that's my default, 99% of the time, I will be okay. It's not going to reject my password. But if I try to do passphrases, I'd say about 70% of the time, it's going to kick me back. So the only time I use passphrases are things that have to be typed in or remembered, like decrypting my computer, logging in, maybe like my password manager, just in case I ever need to recover that for some reason. And then there's also websites, just real quick, there's also websites that they don't tell you, but they're cutting off anything after a certain limit. So you might, Michael Basil talked about this years ago, like you might use 99 characters in your password, but they're only reading the first like 40. And then after that, they don't even pay attention. Like you could only put in the first 40. So, and I'm not saying every website does that, but yeah, it's just, I don't know. I just think you're hitting diminishing returns after a certain time. And it's just, even with a password manager, it's just not really worth it.
The only like valid argument for having longer passwords, because it's not really that necessary, is it's a bit more future-proof. You know, over time, the password requirements are going to continue to rise. People are going to want more and more secure passwords. And if you already generated 50 character passwords 10 years ago, then yeah, you don't really have to update them. So you're kind of like making your life easier in the long run if you don't have to do 100 characters. But you know, if you go well beyond the recommendation, which I think 30, 35, 40 definitely does, then you don't have to worry about it the next 5 years minimum.
At the very end, David Johnson has a quick brief question for me specifically. He says, do you know of a good resource for suggested workflows on how to accomplish common tasks efficiently on Qubes that don't needlessly nullify the protections? Switch to Linux has tutorials, but they're mostly about setting up and maintaining, not daily tasks. Honestly, I would say like, feel free to reach out to me and ask more specifically, because I don't know what you mean by common tasks. Like, okay, so I don't want to get into this because this could be a whole video in and of itself, but I have a handful of Qubes. So I have, I think I talked about this last week. I have a cryptocurrency Qube now that is all by itself. And that's where like my Monero, my Bitcoin are. I have a new oil Qube. I have a personal Qube. I have like a banking, healthcare, important stuff Qube. And I have a day job Qube. And I think that's all of them. I might have a couple stragglers. My first go-to for anything is the repos. So like GNU caches in the repos, Thunderbird, things like that. And then I'm trying to use Qubes the way it was intended more often. So don't be mad at me. I'm mad about this too. But I use snaps for anything that's not in the repos. I would like to use Flatpaks. And I know Michael Lee made a thing for Flatpaks. But I know not all Flatpaks are official, and I don't think that thing has been updated in a while, and I don't know if it needs to be honest, so I don't use that. But it is a really neat project, and I really love it. And that's kind of how I do 99% of everything. And then if it's not there, I'll either get the app image, or I'll download like an RPM, and I'll install it directly in the template. I'll download it somewhere else, move it to the template, and install it for the record. So that's kind of my workflow, and I mean, I've never really had any issues. I guess I would need more info, but hopefully that's helpful. That's kind of how I run things, personally.
The Qubes documentation on their website is pretty good.
It is. Yeah, actually, it is really... Even an idiot like me can understand it.
Yeah, they do a good job breaking a pretty complicated operating system down in a simple way. But my God, their community, their resources, they're not bad, but they just need to be better geared towards normies. I don't see money, and you know, this is something we could probably do better. We could be the change that we're asking for here. There just aren't very many people who I think are bringing Qubes in front of people in a way that can actually sell Qubes onto them. Because Qubes, you know, it's labeled as like this extreme privacy and security tool, but it really could be just as equally like, yeah, it's a great operating system for people who have to manage 8 different things and they don't want to have 8 different browsers installed on their computer that they have to like manage and maintain. So Qubes in some ways could actually be a more efficient operating system. And if somebody, I think, put a guide together that pretty much demonstrated why Qubes is so powerful for even regular users, it could really be a cool selling point for Qubes. But I don't see much of that discussion or communication happening around Qubes, which is pretty unfortunate.
It's funny. I was actually going to push back on you until you made that point about like managing multiple things. You're not wrong. Because that's the thing is like Qubes is such an intensive OS. First of all, like just those of you who have looked into it know the specs are insane compared to like, you know, you go down to Walmart and buy a $200 Chromebook and you're good to go. The only other thought I had is I remember the time you called me. I was like out in public. I remember where I was actually. I was at Dave and Buster's with some friends and you called me and you were like, tell me about Qubes. And I'm like, what? And you're like, why do you use Qubes? I'm filming a video. I'm like, oh, hold on. Let me get somewhere a little quieter. And so I had to step outside and you like basically asked me why I use Qubes. And that was actually my answer is like, I don't technically need it for my threat model. I just like the separation and the ability at the time, you know, to have like multiple signal accounts and multiple matrix accounts and like to have that kind of separation. It was really handy. So yeah, that is definitely a good use case for it.
And to speak on the specs, this is a Qubes laptop right here. It was shipped to me with 48 gigabytes of RAM.
Oh my God.
To give you some context.
I will say for the record, for anybody who's like, what the f-? Like, you don't need that. Like my Qubes device has 16 gigs. So here's what you need. You need at least 16 gigs of RAM. You need at least a recent i5 because I have an i5. That's what I'm struggling with right now is my processor's not fast enough. But the RAM is fine and you need a solid state. To me, those are the three big things. Nitro Key sells, they call them Nitro Pads. They're preloaded with Qubes. The New Oil has an affiliate link. Feel free to help us out. And also if you go to Qubes website, they have a bunch of other vendors that they've listed that sell preloaded laptops. Go with one of those and you can't go wrong. But also at least that'll give you an idea of like what to look for. And also Qubes website has a hardware compatibility list that lists like every computer people have tested. So yeah, there's a lot of resources out there.
If you were a cryptid, what kind of cryptid would you be? I don't even know. I didn't even know what this was before we started recording. Nate explained it to me, and I still don't know what I would be. I would be a nonviolent, chill cryptid, whatever that is.
You got to fall down the cryptid rabbit hole, man. Just go to Wikipedia and look at a list of cryptids. It's a fun time. I'm not even joking. It's fun. Just for like an hour.
Okay. I will look while you're talking.
I have spent an unholy amount of time thinking about, follow me because this is going to sound weird, thinking about my body, just in the sense of like, I watch a fair amount of horror movies, not a ton, but like, so like body horror really gets me. I know I need to watch The Substance. I haven't watched it yet. Don't spoil it, please. Anything other than a humanoid cryptid like Bigfoot would be probably weird. I guess if I was born as a cryptid, I wouldn't really know any better. But yeah, I feel like you. I feel like I would be like Bigfoot from Futurama.
Oh, no, I'd be a Mongolian death worm.
Dude, I was about to say, so not the question you asked, but my favorite cryptid is by a wide margin the Mongolian death worm. And I really hope it's real because it is so metal and so cool. But I wouldn't want to be one. Like I said, I would want to be something humanoid, but like, oh, yeah, the Mongolian death worm is metal. If you guys haven't heard of that one, go look it up next time you're, if you're not driving or something, go pause and look up the Mongolian death worm. It's so metal. If you like Dune, you'll like the Mongolian death worm.
I would not be one of the carnivorous mammals, like the British big cat or the Nandi bear or the thylacine.
The Tasmanian tiger.
Yes, the Tasmanian tiger. It's scary how you know all of the ones I'm talking about.
I listen to a wide, wide, wide range of stuff. So like I listen to true crime, I listen to tech stuff, I listen to the news, I listen to conspiracy theory stuff, I listen to relationship stuff. I mentioned Jordan Harbinger. Like I listen to all kinds of stuff. So yes, I know. And I just told you, I went through the list. I mean, years ago, it's probably updated by now. It's a fun rabbit hole, man. Cause then there's like the Tasmanian tiger is a really good example. Like there's some sightings that are just like, okay, grandpa, you were drunk, go home. But then there's some sightings that are actually like really credible. And it's an Australian animal. So it's like, well, I mean, it's Tasmanian, but it comes in one of those places where it's like, well, crap, man, maybe there's like a small population living somewhere in the desert. Like, I don't know. It's a fun thought experiment. That's what I like about cryptids. I like this one too. And thank you, by the way, Brandon, for asking these questions. I like the fun questions. What do you think about the simulation hypothesis? Again, I spend way too much time in my own head, and I have thought about this a lot. I think I come down on the side of it's probably true. I've heard enough arguments that say the simulation hypothesis is probably true that I'm kind of like, I wouldn't say I'm married to the idea, but I'm like, well, my world wouldn't be upended if we found out for sure it was. I'm kind of already like 80% of the way there. But then I come back to the moral side of it where I'm like, but does that make a difference? Like, does that justify, and for the record, my answer is no before anybody gets mad. Does that justify crime and murder and war crimes and all these terrible things happening in the world? Because they're all pixels and it doesn't matter. And my answer is, I don't think so because I'm sentient, even if I'm, you know, AGI that's gotten carried away. I think I'm sentient. I think therefore I am. I'm assuming it's the same for Henry. I'm assuming it's the same for you listening to this or watching this video right now. Like, I don't think that somehow makes our lives matter any less. That's kind of where I land on it is I think it's probably true, but at the end of the day, I don't think it really matters because I think we should still try to be good people and take care of the program we're in. But I have some serious beef with the programmers because I'm not happy with how a lot of things are turning out. And also real quick, I'm sorry if I just gave anybody an existential crisis.
Yeah, I don't feel this way at all about it. I mean,
you don't think it's true?
I don't have a thought towards it. It's just, it's one of those things that in my mind, it's like, there's no way to know and it doesn't change anything. So why do I care? What I've noticed, if you want to get philosophical, I might really come at people here with this. The people I know who are most obsessed about simulation hypothesis are the people who just can't cope with a lack of control in their lives.
And that's fair. I was about to say, I think that's probably why I came to the whole, like, it doesn't really matter conclusion is because it's like, it's so out of my control that it makes me feel kind of helpless.
I think that's why people obsess over it. They don't like the feeling of this lack of control. Like there's something that's bigger than them that puts them in a situation where they can't really do anything about it. So I think it's why this discussion has become so big. And I think the people who are the loudest in the room are the people who feel the most insecure about like the amount of control they have in their lives. So that's always been my take on it. I don't think it's a wrong question or a bad question to ask, but it's why personally I'm like, I mean, you know, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. I haven't really seen a compelling reason to say that it is. People just speculate because I think just the thought of it is like scary to a lot of people. So the last question is pretty much running your own Monero node. So they're saying that, yeah, running your own Monero node helps decentralize and secure the Monero network, but does it give you, like an individual, a personal privacy or security benefit? So of course, they do mention using a VPN, which normally is one of the benefits because you get IP address protection by running your own node. But there is some metadata leakage that can still happen when you use someone else's node. So there is some metadata protection when you run your own node and you know how it's being handled. I think the biggest thing too is that you know it's not a malicious node. I know there was some stuff like what, 6 to 12 months ago about a malicious Monero node that was going around, or a couple of them that were like actually malicious, and they were used across the board by a lot of people. And fortunately, Monero has a lot of protections in place where even a completely compromised node still can't quite do what they really hope it does. But it still created a lot of questions. And it was another reminder that if you're somebody with a high threat model, running your own node is a really good thing to do. You can also independently verify transactions against the blockchain. You run your own node, you make your own rules. And on top of all of that, like you said, you are helping the entire Monero ecosystem, right? Like you're helping decentralize structure, you're helping the health of the ecosystem, and you're also taking control of your own privacy and security. So there's a lot of perks. With that said, I think if you're just a typical Monero user, as someone who really enjoys the Monero community, something that's said a lot is like, you need to run your own Monero node. I don't disagree with that. I just think that like, I don't run my own Monero node and I still get a ton of value and I still get a lot of benefit from just using Monero as is. So don't feel intimidated if you're not running your own Monero node as if you're doing something wrong. Just go ahead, just make sure you're using semi-trusted nodes that are well-known, well-reputable. And then once something is labeled as a malicious node, obviously stop using it. And in the meantime, you can use VPNs or Tor and just be careful with your transactions. And it's always safe to assume that a node could be compromised and just act as if that's the truth. And that's why you should use things like Monero that still have protections in place, even with a malicious node. You'll see this pattern a lot with a lot of the tools we use and recommend, which is we like to assume they're compromised, right? Like Signal has the threat model of if the server's compromised, it still doesn't really matter because there's really no metadata or direct data that the server can really achieve. There's not much incentive whatsoever for someone to hack a Signal server. What they need to do is hack the end device, which is your device. So this is pretty applicable to a lot of the things we talk about. Last thing I'll say, I'm not a Monero expert, so I'm kind of relaying a lot of what I've heard from other people in the Monero community. So if anything I said is like slightly incorrect, please go ahead and correct me in the comments.
I have nothing to add. I am also not a Monero expert, but that tracks with what I've heard and what I know.
That is it. Again, we got some Monero questions. We got some password questions. We got some interesting questions about cryptids and simulations and also Qubes. All of these questions come from people who love and support our podcast, and we can't do it without them. We love them back. If you want to keep this podcast going forever and ever, you can make that happen by joining us and joining our Patreon, sending us tips on XMR chat. And in doing so, you can also join our Q&As and ask us anything you want. Ideally, safe for work. That's it. Thank you all for tuning in, and we'll see you next week.